So I want to talk about some of the cloud strategy, how you want to plan your cloud strategy. To start, why do you need a cloud strategy in the first place, right? Is it because you want to talk something about in your next board meeting? Definitely not, right? So I want to split the cloud strategy into four different parts and then talk about here one by one. So first is there are lots of cloud services available. So what's your strategy about the cloud services? How you are going to use the cloud services in your organization? Then there are cloud identities available. Almost all the people are having Facebook, all the people are having Twitter, and so on. So what's your strategy on letting people who are having those credentials to access your applications? Then development in the cloud is becoming more and more common, so we'll talk about that as well. And then running your applications in the cloud, which is again very important. So let's talk about that. So cloud services. So there are tons of services available. Like in WSO2, we are using like at least like 20, 30 cloud services now. Again, most of these cloud services are like SaaS applications are very common these days. And if in your organization, if you are not using now, most probably you will be starting to use it in a couple of years. But then when there are tons of services available, each of these services are providing various functionalities, various useful functionalities, so you what's your strategy on using them. So in open source, the open source got a very high momentum because a concept called standing on the shoulders of giants. People build software, people build functionality, and then people use it as a library in their application when they build their new applications. So now the trend is put that thought or put that methodology in the API, so in the cloud services. Basically, the cloud services and APIs are available. Some useful functionalities are available. So when you build your applications, how you are using them to build your own applications, right? So, and you or some of your customers might be already using these functionalities. So how you your developers, how are you going to let your developers to use any of these functionalities if they are interested in using any of these? Then second part is cloud identity. So let's say you are building a new applications, and how many of you don't have Facebook credentials now? Almost all the people are having Facebook, right? So if you are going to use an application, and if the application is providing you to create your own credentials there, own identity within that applications, or they give an option to use your Facebook credentials, right? Let's say if there are such facilities available, how many of you choose to create a new credentials on that particular application, or how many of you choose to use your Facebook credentials to access the application, right? Majority of the people will try to use their Facebook credentials. I try to use Facebook credentials wherever it says you can log in using Facebook. The advantage is, first thing is you don't need to remember multiple passwords, but the other stuff is you don't need to create accounts in all over the places. So there are tons of cloud identities available. How you are going to bring them into your application? When you are building an application, how you are going to enable your consumers, your users to use those credentials to access your application? That is one. The other one is even your internal organization, you have some identities. And when you are using the cloud services available, how your employees will be accessing those cloud services by using your enterprise identities, right? Again, in WSO2, we use like Concur, we use People HR, et cetera, et cetera. We use our own credential, our WSO2 credentials to access those applications, not creating different credentials in those systems, right? So we'll look at how we can achieve those as well. then the application development is changing now, right? It's becoming more and more agile. You come up with a new idea, you want to develop the application, try it out as soon as possible. And it's always API driven nowadays. There are lots of APIs, there are lots of functionalities already available, so you want to use them straight away. Again, Asanga talked about polyglot languages. Basically, there are different languages, there are different technologies, there are different data sources available. So you might want to use any of those stuff available, right? And the application releases has to be quick releases, because the application idea you are getting now might be outdated in 1 year time, right? So whatever the idea you are having now, you have to just get it done right now itself, rather than waiting for some more years. So the releases has to be very frequent. You have to do quick releases with feature added and so on. Again, one of the other concept is long tail of applications. So this is a blog post written sometime back. So generally, if your application development cost is very high, you will develop the application only when it is used by multiple people, right? So only way you would allow people to write any kind of application is to bring down the cost of application development, right? So if the cost of developing an application is very small, then even though if the particular application is useful for two or three people, you can actually allow people to build that application, because it will be like a couple of hours, you build a new application, you push it to the runtime, and people can start using it, right? So supporting that long tail of applications, even though the application is used by only a small number of people, you allow that such kind of application to be developed is one of the advantage of using cloud development. Again, cloud runtime. People talk about microservices, etc. Again, Frank talked about the circuit breaker. Frank talked about the hot pooling, etc. So the requirement now is you should be able to run any kind of stuff in a very small amount of time in the cloud. I'll come back to that later on some of the technologies. Again, at the moment, the load is unpredictable. For example, you come up with an idea for the application now, you put it on cloud, you run it on cloud, you share the link on Facebook, possibly 10 people might be accessing, or possibly 10,000 people might be accessing the next moment, right? That's kind of a viral nature is there nowadays. So when you are designing your application, when you run the applications, you have to cater for those kind of requirements. So the predictability of the load is very less. So you have to have provision in order to cover that. And then when you have a distributed system, when your application is kind of distributed, then the scalability requirements of different parts of your application will be different, right? So again, when you design the applications, you have to cater for that as well. So we'll look at how cloud can help there. Again, our conventional relationship with IT is always nightmare, right? When we want to create a database, we ask the IT guys. They take a couple of days and get back and say, okay, we need to provision some machines so that I can create a database. And now you ask for a tender, you wait for months, and you wait for months after that, you get the database done, right? So this kind of cost, this kind of delays brings lots of nightmare for the developers. So if I want to create a new applications, rather than going through the IT, conventional IT, I might end up just swiping my credit card, create an EC2 instance, and create the applications there, right? It's much easier, much faster for me to try out some ideas and develop it. However, that is a problem, which is called the shadow IT. So when the application goes into the production, now I might have used some of the not allowed libraries, so some of the problematic libraries or problematic licenses in my applications, because nobody knew that I was building an applications like that, right? So all of that is a common problem in application development now. So what you need actually is kind of a self-service runtime and the development environment, which is a self-service, so that I can go and just create an instance. If I want to create an applications, I go and create a database, I go and create an application server, I go and create a presentation layer, write the applications, and push it to the production, right? Or push it to the development testing, QA testing, and so on. So the organizations now start to provide the developers on some environments where people can go and self-service create instances and start writing the applications. Again, the demand on the application development methodologies are different. I might be interested on Java, somebody else might be interested on PHP, somebody else might be interested on JavaScript, and so on. And again, in the database, somebody might be interested on NoSQL, other people might be interested on RDBMS, and so on. So the technologies, the language choice, the database choice, there are various different choices. So how you provide all of that combinations for your developers, for them to write applications when they get a new idea, right? Again, the environment and the development methodology should be workflow driven. Basically, I need applications, but possibly the IT might be forcing some of the compliance rules. I might be able to use only Apache license libraries, or I might be only allowed to use only if the IT head approves my applications, or I might be allowed to develop application only if the finance team approve my budget, and so on, right? So there has to be the developers or the IT providers have to configure some workflow so that people can come and go through the workflow as part of human interactions, human approval process, or various other workflow driven activities. Again, APIs is hard and soul of today's development. So the development has to support any of the APIs, public APIs or private APIs, etc. So it has to be API driven. And it should accept creative experimentation. So when I get an idea, it shouldn't inhibit me not to be able to develop an application. That means it has to be low cost, it has plenty of technology choices available for me to select something. The amount of time I spend to create the application and push it to the runtime should be very less, should be able to, I should be able to do on my own, and so on. So this creative experimentation is very important for the cloud development. Low-cost development, runtime environments, I already talked about. Again, how all these came into the picture? What are the technologies helping us to achieve it? First thing is the Docker, the containers, container models, right? So Frank talked about the hot pool. Basically, when you run 8 number of instances with 80% of success rate of an application, you will get 99.99% of high availability, right? That means you should be able to find the problems in the running instance, and very short amount of period, you should be able to shut it down and start it up. That is the circuit breaker pattern Frank talked about, right? All of that could be achieved by using the containers. So container is a very lightweight runtime environment. You can equate it to the virtual machines, but it shares the kernel between each and every container. So it's much more lightweight. Within milliseconds, you can start up a new container. And the overhead added by a new container is very less. So in a laptop, you will be able to run like 200, 300 containers very easily, right? So that is the low weight functionality provided by containers like Docker. And then the Docker is invented for single machines. Then on top of that, the Kubernetes came and built the technology, right? So when you have multiple machines, how do you orchestrate the applications on multiple machines? So Kubernetes call them as pods. POTS is a combination of multiple Docker images. You can use some other containers as well. However, in Kubernetes terms, you talk about pods. For example, in as an example, let's say you have an HTTPD and a PH and a MySQL running. So you can define the HTTPD as one of the container, MySQL as one of the container, and then you can define both together as one of the pod, right? So the pod means the HTTPD, which is running the PHP code, and the MySQL running the database. So the advantage of defining it as pod is when the instance is created, it will be always created on the single machines. The pod will be created, all the containers within the pod will be created in a single machines, or at the same machines, right? So if you want two or three pods running for high availability, one will be created on one machine, the other one will be created on other machines, but you have the data locality, etc. Right? So again, this model allows you to automatically manage how many instances of the application server you want to run, or how you want to access the data, etc. Right? So very convenient way of managing your applications. And on top of Kubernetes, people define something called Ubernetes. Right? So Kubernetes is for a data center. Then the next question is, OK, I want to run something on the EC2 as well as on Rackspace so that I can get more high availability. Right? So Kubernetes allows you to create the environments in a single data center. And on top of that, this Ubernetes allows you to orchestrate between multiple Kubernetes clusters. Right? So again, fancy stuff. But still, something you had to consider when you design or when you develop your applications. If you know about this, you might select some of the technologies on a conscious way. OK, so let me talk a bit about how WSO2 helps in each of these cases. First thing is API Manager. So Isabel talked about API Manager just start of this session. So I talk about public APIs available. There are plenty of public APIs available. But for your organizations, you might want to restrict only a subset of public APIs which your developers can use, right? So how the developers know which kind of APIs they can consume? One option is you expose those public APIs through your API portal, through your API manager, right? So you can use WSO2 API manager in order to do that. So your developers goes and discovers what are the API they can consume, subscribe to those APIs, and then start using it. Similarly, for your external people, your third party and your application developers, you also can expose your APIs through the API manager so that they can come and consume the APIs. Second is the ESB and the connector. Again, there are so much of SaaS applications available. Often, you might end up with wiring multiple services together to achieve some functionality. For example, we have a requirement to take data from Salesforce, pump it to Google spreadsheet, and make it sync on a periodic basis so that people can go and discover what are the customers available, etc. That's a useful functionality, right? So ESB and the connectors can help to do that. So we have something called store.wso2.com. You can go and download connectors. We have around 150 odd connectors now for various SaaS applications. So by downloading those connectors, you can wire them together to create some integration flows and start using them. Again, the next step of integration, the ESB and the connectors, is something called the WSO2 Integration Cloud. Basically, this allows you to manage and execute the execution flows, or commonly used scenarios designed as integration flows, so that people can get and start using it. Right? Again, one of the common criteria is or common functionality is like you take something from the Twitter, send a mail to you every time there is a key hashtag or something is used, right? So the integration clouds allows to create some commonly used patterns or commonly used recipes or commonly used integration templates and allow you to configure with your credentials, right? So you create a template first, but you instantiate the template multiple times with various credentials so that it will do the wiring with various services. The next product we can help is the identity server in order to bridge the cloud identity, your internal identity, and so on. So one of the problem on the identity space is different applications need different credentials. Some of them need SAML tokens, some of them need OAuth tokens, some of them need basic auth, and so on. Again, people are having various identity models, various, you have Twitter, you have your internal organization's internal ID, you have Google ID, and so on, right? So the identity server acts as a federation bus where you take one identity, and let's say you have a SAML token from your internal organization, internal identity, and you want to access an OAuth-enabled applications. So the identity server can help you to convert the SAML token into an OAuth token in order to access that particular application, right? So you log in only once to your identity server, and then from there onwards, it converts your token, converts your identity, your claims into whatever the way it has to access the other applications, right? So it provides the federation between various systems by converting your identity, by converting your tokens, and then access various systems. As part of that is the identity provisioning as well. I mentioned about, okay, you have several identities you already have, and let's say you are using Facebook identity in order to access one of your application. So you decide to allow them to access the application by using Facebook identity, but still you want to create a user as part of they are accessing your Facebook credential. Let's say that's your requirement. Then this provisioning framework provided by the identity server helps you to do that. So when they try to authenticate to the system, it can let them to authenticate using the Facebook identity, but still creates a user, something called just-in-time provisioning, into your local user store. Also, like people join the company, people leave the company, and so on, right? So if you are using multiple cloud services, when an employee joins, you want to create accounts in various systems. So again, the provisioning framework can help you to create it. So you create only once, then the provisioning goes to Google system, goes to Salesforce, goes to various other systems and create the identities. When the employee leaves, you can deprovision the user and then it will go and deprovision from all the systems. So it's a integration of identities, and there is a single place where you can control who can access what applications, etc. Then we can run WSO2 products on top of Kubernetes as well. So this is a reference architecture we have done for the Kubernetes. Basically, if you use WSO2 products, you can know, you would have known that there is a management node clusters and a worker node clusters. So you define different replication factor for management node and different replication factor for worker nodes, right? Often at a runtime, the worker nodes has to be scaled up much quickly than the management nodes. So it's a different requirements for the scalable requirements. And possibly even the management node is down, you can survive. You are not doing the management activity all the time, right? But if a worker node is down, that means your live traffic is cut down. So you need to put lots of effort into keeping this worker node cluster running continuously. So you define the replication factor on a much higher value and can configure the clusters in this way. Okay, and then the next one is the WSO2 cloud. Again, we provide support in three different cases. First is the private PaaS, WSO2 PaaS offerings. This allows you to run any applications on top of multiple PaaS frameworks like Apache Stratos, Kubernetes, Cloud Foundry, MesOS, OpenShift, etc. Right? So basically, it can be WSO2 products, or it can be any other products, any other application like PHP or WebSphere or anything. Basically, it allows you to run them in a controlled manner, so that you can manage the applications from a single point of view. So that is the PaaS offerings. Then we are building, we already have the API cloud running now, and we have an app cloud running on a beta version. We are working on identity cloud and integration cloud as part of our public cloud offering. So people can come and create applications, can create APIs, and start using within the applications, et cetera. So that is the public cloud offering. Again, the public cloud is a hosted version, but you can take it as a software and then deploy it internally for your purpose as well. Then the third option is the managed cloud, where we deploy the WSO2 products on top of either EC2 or OpenStack, or primarily on the Amazon EC2. And then we manage, as WSO2, we manage to keep them up and running all the time, so that people can come up here, the end users can use the system. So this is a service we offer for the customers, taking burden of managing the system from them. We manage them, we provide them SLAs for them to keep it up and running. Right? So these are the areas where WSO2 helps to achieve the cloud strategy. But actually, the cloud strategy depends on what your organization's requirement and has to be tailor-made for that particular organization, right? Okay, that's the end of the